actually help them.
Yeah, good.
Yes.
Don't say that.
I got more if you need.
No, I'm good. Thank you. Are you also from Preston, okay?
Kind of monitor the situation here.
Where do you work?
KRC. Busy meeting.
At what?
KRC.
Oh, is that on the radio?
I do it, so like literally takes me 10 minutes to get there.
Things come.
No.
Still get some of that reporter life.
Exactly, yeah, it feels like, you know, kind of exciting.
Good afternoon, everyone. I just have some photos I'm gonna present on the call. Good wait. Who's here while we're waiting?
My name's Kelsey Barrow, I'm with the North Bay Organizing Project, and I'm here on behalf of KBBS.
Nice to meet you.
Risa Endicott, I'm with the Preston Cop.
What's your last name?
Endicott.
Endicott, oh, of course.
Hey, Carla, Matt Brown with the County Communications Team.
Photographer.
Oh, Chris Chung, Preston Cop.
Nice to meet you.
Jim Sweeney, Preston Cop.
Andrew Graham, also with the Preston Cop. There's a lot of us. Yeah.
Noah Abrams, not with the Preston Cop, I work at KRC.
Great.
I'm Alex Hall with KQED.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too.
Will I be able to click on?
No, but I can click the mouse earlier. Is the, is it a PowerPoint?
Yeah.
I think the keyboard and the just. Okay. So is this phone?
That one. Thank you all for coming. My name is Carla Rodriguez, I'm the District Attorney of Sonoma County. I want to express my condolences to the family of David Pelaez-Chavez. The loss of life, no matter what the circumstances are, is a very somber and devastating event. Mr. Pelaez-Chavez's family and friends will always be impacted by his death. David's nephews, cousins, co-workers, and acquaintances will always be affected by this tragedy. I'm sorry for their loss of life. As district attorney, my job is to review the facts and the laws fairly and impartially as possible to determine one issue. Was a crime committed when Deputy Michael Dietrich shot and killed David Pelaez-Chavez on July 29, 2022? Peace officer's authority to use deadly force is a serious responsibility that must be exercised judiciously with respect for human rights and with respect for the sanctity of every human life. My duty to the community is to review the evidence collected fairly and impartially and to apply the facts of the case to the law. It is my duty to evaluate the use of force carefully and thoroughly in a manner that reflects the gravity of the authority conferred upon the police and the very, very serious toll that these acts take on families, loved ones, and our communities. This investigation was conducted according to our protocol with the Santa Rosa Police Department. According to the Sonoma County Officer Involved Shooting Protocol, if there is an event involving death or serious bodily injury at the hands of a police officer, an uninvolved agency will take up that investigation. The district attorney's office assists with any background legal issues. We receive the investigation, we make the appropriate charges. Standing here to my right is Chief Deputy Andrew Lucas, who assisted with the legal analysis and the collection of evidence. Assistant District Attorney Brian Stavell, who also assisted me with the legal analysis, and victim advocate Rocio Murphy, who was assigned to this case and who spoke to the Mr. Pelaez-Chavez's family this morning. Our legal analysis has changed in recent years. On January 1st, 2020, AB 392 went into effect and rewrote the law relating to when use of force by police is acceptable. The new law is argued to have raised the bar in regards to when police can use deadly force. It is very clear that the authority to use physical force by peace officers is a serious responsibility. It should be reviewed with the utmost scrutiny by the reviewing parties, which would be me, and with respect for human rights and dignity and for the sanctity of every human life. Under the new law, peace officers may only use deadly force when necessary in defense of human life. Under the new law, peace officers shall use other available resources and techniques if reasonably safe and feasible, as seen through the eyes of an objectively reasonable officer. A couple of points of law that I want to emphasize to you. An officer's use of force shall be evaluated from the perspective of a reasonable officer in the same situation based on everything known or perceived by that officer at the time. So it's a reasonable officer standard. The law does not allow for the benefit of hindsight. We cannot go back and say the officer should have done this, should have done that, could have done this, could have done that. The law recognizes and requires me to account for occasions when officers may be forced to make quick judgments about using force. This is the law. Further, under existing law and case law, an officer who attempts to make an arrest need not retreat or desist by reason of the resistance or threatened resistance of the person being arrested. Giving you the bare bones of what the law is in this case and what my legal analysis was, the ultimate legal question in this case is, were Deputy Michael Dietrich's actions objectively reasonable in light of the totality of the facts and circumstances known to him on July 29, 2022. I have reviewed body-worn camera video. I reviewed slowed down versions of body-worn camera video from both Deputy Dietrich and Deputy Powers. We have reviewed the whole team, surveillance photos from several residences that were involved in this incident on July 29th. We've reviewed text messages and information found on telephone belonging to Mr. Pelaez-Chavez's girlfriend, interviews of witnesses, interviews of Mr. Pelaez-Chavez's loved ones and family, catalogs, dispatch logs, autopsy report, drug report. We've looked at all relevant available evidence in making our decision. The events leading up to the shooting actually started a couple days prior to July 29, 2022. David Pelaez-Chavez was living in Lower Lake, California with his girlfriend. He began accusing her of cheating on him. He actually sent her a screenshot as they were talking on FaceTime saying, "I can see your boyfriend or your male visitor in the back." There was no male in the back of the screenshot that she sent him. On July 28, 2022, the text messages between Mr. Pelaez-Chavez and his girlfriend continued. At 9:17 p.m., he wrote her something to the effect of, quote, last night I drove around looking for an officer to stop me and to not stop until I crashed. These messages indicated some kind of delusion, possible drug use. It is noteworthy that evidence of methamphetamine was later found in Mr. Pelaez-Chavez's residence as well as in his system upon conclusion of the autopsy. On July 29th, 2022, at 12:47 a.m., Mr. Pelaez-Chavez left his girlfriend a voice message and accused her of calling the police on him and told her he was going to light her car on fire. He also told her that he believed she was involved with another man and that she was going to regret it. At 1:53 a.m. on July 29th, 2022, Mr. Pelaez-Chavez left another voice message to his girlfriend saying something similar to, you're going to regret this. I'll die before I let them get me. At 5:40 a.m., a rural worker in the area of Highway 128 near Halesburg observed a Nissan driving quickly down a dirt road off of Highway 128. About 10 minutes later, the worker found the Nissan abandoned on a dirt road. About 2 hours later, this abandoned car was reported to the Sonoma County Sheriff's Dispatch. The driver was described as suspicious. At that point, Deputy Dietrich responded to the scene of the abandoned car. At that point, he did not tow the car. He did not do anything with the car. I'm going to go through a series of residences, if I can. So this is a map of the general area where the events took place on July 29th, 2022. I'm going to get back in the slideshow mode. Okay. The area where the car was abandoned was not is not on this map, but we find that Mr. Pelaez-Chavez went to two different residences after the car was abandoned, the first being further west on Tremonti Lane in Hillsburg, and the second being a little bit to the east. This map also shows the area where the police ultimately caught up with Mr. Pelaez-Chavez and shot him. At around 8:13 a.m., Mr. Pelaez-Chavez was identified on surveillance video walking up the driveway of what I'm going to call residence number one. It was a large property in a rural part of Hillsburg. Mr. Pelaez-Chavez was seen holding rocks in his hand. Resident number one was sitting in his home office, this is at 8:14 a.m. approximately, when he saw Mr. Pelaez-Chavez. He noted that Mr. Pelaez-Chavez was barefoot, carrying the rocks. He watched Mr. Pelaez drop the rocks, take a sip of water from the fountain, grab the rocks again, and walk towards the house. He thought this behavior was unusual. He gets up from his desk to talk to Mr. Pelaez-Chavez when he hears the sounds of his French doors shattering, his glass French doors shattering. Resident number one, as I'm referring to him, got a pistol from his safe, and he confronted Mr. Pelaez-Chavez outside the shattered door. He fired two warning shots into the air and followed him. At the same time, his daughter called 911, called dispatch to report the intruder. There was a gardener working at residence number one. He was working in a flower bed when he heard the gunshots. the gardener watched Mr., as I'm referred to, watched Mr. Pelaez-Chavez get into the driver's seat of his truck that was parked nearby. The gardener ran to his truck to stop Mr. Pelaez-Chavez from stealing it. He tried to open the door, but the defendant had locked it. The gardener reached through the window to stop Mr. Pelaez-Chavez from stealing his car. Mr. Pelaez-Chavez accelerated in the truck at a high rate of speed forward and dragged the gardener approximately 20 feet down the driveway. The gardener became very afraid for his safety and let go. Mr. Pelaez-Chavez then drove through a gate and then through a fence, got the stuck truck in a ditch, and fled on foot. This is the truck. Mr. Pelaez-Chavez caused several thousand dollars worth of damage to both resident number one's home and the gardener's truck. During this time, Deputy Dietrich responded to residence number one and spoke to the victims. Around 8:45, Mr. Pelaez-Chavez next went to residence number two. And going back to the back. Residence number one. Residence number two. The people living at residence number two saw Mr. Pelaez-Chavez on their surveillance video. They described him as dirty and disheveled, carrying three rocks about the size of cantaloupes. The owner of this residence asked David in Spanish if he could help him. David responded in broken English, help me, there is someone trying to kill me. This resident described Mr. Pelaez-Chavez as high on methamphetamine. Resident number two was concerned for his safety due to Mr. Pelaez-Chavez's erratic behavior, possible drug use, and the fact that he was holding large rocks. He then got a call from his neighbor, resident number one, who warned him that a man was just at his house, threw a rock through a window, stole a truck, and drove through several gates and fences, and was headed towards his house. Resident number two went to grab a gun and went back outside. Mr. Pelaez-Chavez started to walk away when resident number two ordered him to sit down and wait for police to arrive. Mr. Pelaez-Chavez told him, shoot me, then walked away. According to the dispatch logs, it was around 8:50 at this time, and both Deputy Dietrich and his backup, Deputy Powers, arrived at residence number two. They accepted a ride in his ATV to locate Mr. Pelaez-Chavez. And the photo is one showing Mr. Pelaez-Chavez walking in the area of residence number two. This is the view from residence number two looking out to the land beyond his house where the pursuit of Mr. Pelaez-Chavez began. It was very rough terrain, very hilly terrain. It was 8:45 in the morning in July, I believe already getting hot. That is the view from the other side. So we have the view from the edge of the ridge and the view at the bottom of the hill up to the same ridge where residence number two is. This is very steep terrain, very difficult terrain to navigate. Deputy Michael Dietrich and Deputy Powers accepted assistance from resident number two with an ATV. Deputy Dietrich got in the ATV with the resident to look for Mr. Pelaez-Chavez. Deputy Powers and Deputy Dietrich encountered a third person, a ranch hand, who was associated with a third residence that was nearby. The ranch hand advised the deputies that a man had just come and stolen an ATV and taken off of the ATV. The deputies alone now went to go look for Mr. Pelaez-Chavez, and while en route, found an abandoned ATV stuck in the ground somehow. They continued to look for Mr. Pelaez-Chavez for the next 40 minutes. At this point, Mr. Pelaez-Chavez had stolen a truck and an ATV. For the next 40 minutes, the deputies navigate this terrain? Approximately 1.15 miles? 1.5 miles? The terrain at times is very, very hilly. It's very, very steep. There's brush. The deputies are frequently slipping and falling. Mr. Pelaez-Chavez, who does not have shoes on, is also walking on this terrain. This photo depicts the first time that they see him at the top of this hill. This is from Deputy Powers' body-worn camera. If they started walking at around 8:50, 9 o'clock. The body-worn shows that we're at 9:38. So it's been about 45 minutes that they're following him. Deputy Powers was in the military and spent 8 years as a tracker, trained in tracking people. He climbed up and surveilled Mr. Pelaez-Chavez as he drove on the top of this ridge and tried to remain hidden. Deputy Dietrich caught up with him. At some point, Mr. Pelaez-Chavez realized he was being watched and he continued to run away from the police. This is the view going down the hill. We're at 9:47. At a certain point, one of the deputies, this picture shows just how steep some of the terrain was. At some point, the deputies realize that Mr. Pelaez-Chavez is carrying some tools. They believe it's either an axe or a metal hammer. Go forward. It is later determined that Mr. Pelaez-Chavez, during his pursuit, possibly found in the ATV that was stolen, got a hold of this hammer, this metal hammer, and a metal hand tilling tool. He was carrying this throughout the pursuit. The deputies found it noteworthy that despite traversing this very steep and difficult terrain, slippery and sliding all around, Mr. Pelaez-Chavez kept those tools in his hand the entire time and would not relinquish them. At a certain point, one of the deputies observed Mr. Pelaez-Chavez appearing angry and aggressively hitting a tree with one of the two tools, possibly the metal hand tiller. They noticed that he was agitated. Throughout this pursuit, the deputies were trying to de-escalate the situation. They were asking him if he wanted water. They were talking to him in their broken, poor Spanish, but understandable for Spanish. I would describe Deputy Power's voice as being pleading at times to please stop, to please stop running from them. They followed him. They made many efforts to have him trust them and to stop running away. To Mr. Pelaez-Chavez in a creek bed. There's water in the creek bed. It's 9:50. Pelaez-Chavez at this point takes a rock and makes a motion as if he's going to throw the rock at Deputy Powers. Deputy Powers backs off and gives Mr. Pelaez-Chavez space and basically continues following him at what he believes is a safe distance. And this is about 30 seconds later. That's Mr. Pelaez-Chavez picking up a rock as if to throw it at Deputy Powers. 10 a.m. is when the fatal shooting occurred. Deputy Powers is now in a creek bed following Mr. Pelaez-Chavez, continuing to ask him to stop, to encourage him to stop running. At this point, the two deputies have decided that one of them will employ less lethal methods of detention, And that's Deputy Powers who takes that role. And that one of them will employ lethal methods of protection. And that's Deputy Dietrich. I'll get into this later, but our expert witness, who is experienced in the area of use of force, has advised us that that is a totally reasonable course of action when trying to detain someone who has committed several felonies. So Deputy Powers, being less lethal, has a taser out at this point, and Mr. Pelaez-Chavez, still appearing agitated and angry, is depicted in that picture in front of him. Deputy Dietrich, at the same time, has caught up to them. He wasn't in the military for 8 years, not a marathon runner like Deputy Powers. Took him a little longer to catch up. He sees Mr. Pelaez-Chavez come out of his bed and approach him. Mr. Pelaez-Chavez still seems agitated. At this point, a helicopter has arrived. The helicopter is having trouble seeing them. It does see them, but there's so much tree cover that at times they lose all three figures as they're on the ground. And in essence, the two deputies are at that point alone on the ground with Mr. Pelaez-Chavez. This is a scene, this is a snap photo from Deputy Michael Dietrich's body-worn camera. So we have Deputy Powers behind in the creek bed and Mr. Pelaez-Chavez exiting the creek bed and coming towards Deputy Powers. Deputy Powers asks him to stop, tells him to stop, tells him to drop his weapons. At this point, Mr. Pelaez-Chavez becomes very agitated by the helicopter above. He holds his hands up in the air. He's holding the till and the hammer in one hand and the rock in his right hand, screaming at the helicopter. He appears to become tired. He bends down. He drops the rock to the ground while looking at the deputies. This is the view from Deputy Powers' body worn. That's Deputy Michael Dietrich, Deputy Powers. The creek is over here. Our expert opined that there's about 10 to 15 feet between the parties. Mr. Pelaez-Chavez bends down, he drops the rock while looking at the deputies. He attempts to pick up another rock, and Deputy Dietrich shoots him 3 times, resulting in his death. After Deputy Dietrich shot and killed Mr. Pelaez-Chavez, they administered life-saving measures, and the amount of time that it took for someone from the helicopter to arrive and for backup to arrive, which I'm going to guess is about 20 minutes. They were not able to revive Mr. Pelaez-Chavez, and he died. Santa Rosa Police Department took over the investigation. They interviewed the deputies eventually. They interviewed witnesses. The body was taken to the Marin County Coroner's for an autopsy. And the investigation began. Our office received the investigation in January of this year. Once again, the legal issue for our office is were the deputies justified? Is there a legal defense to their actions? So we retained an expert witness by the name of Jeffrey Noble. We spent a great amount of time looking for an appropriate witness to assist us with the question of whether or not the police officer's actions were objectively reasonable given the totality of the circumstances in place on July 29th, 2022. I did not want to hire someone who I would call a rubber stamp for police use of force. I wanted to find someone whose record and history demonstrates fairness, impartiality, and no favoritism. Jeffrey Noble was provided with the police reports, with the autopsy report, with the drug talks, with the body-worn cameras, with everything that we had. He was also provided a copy of a prior police report relating to Deputy Dietrich's prior use of force shooting that happened in 2016 in Lake County. Bottom line, Jeffrey Noble concluded in a report that was given to us last month that Deputy Dietrich's belief was reasonable. His belief that he needed to use deadly force to prevent harm to himself or his partner was objectively reasonable in light of the facts and circumstances known to him on July 29, 2022. The facts and circumstances that Mr. Noble took into consideration when reaching his conclusions were that Mr. Pelaez-Chavez was under the influence of methamphetamine, as described by numerous civilian witnesses and the tox results received post-mortem. Mr. Pelaez-Chavez was armed with rocks and was throwing rocks and was carrying them. Mr. Pelaez-Chavez was armed with a metal hammer as well as a metal till that he would not relinquish during this very lengthy and difficult and arduous pursuit. Mr. Pelaez-Chavez was unresponsive to the deputy's efforts at rapport building. He was unresponsive to the deputy's de-escalation efforts. Mr. Pelaez-Chavez was unresponsive to their commands to stop. And Mr. Pelaez-Chavez had been acting erratically throughout the entire day. The issue in this legal analysis is what the deputy Dietrich know or what was he aware of at the time of the deadly shooting. And at the time of the deadly shooting, he was dealing with an individual who was under the influence of drugs, highly agitated, not making sense, and aggressive and dangerous. At the time of the shooting, Deputy Dietrich had knowledge that Mr. Pelaez-Chavez had the apparent ability, the opportunity, and the apparent intent to cause serious bodily injury or death to the deputies. In other words, if our office were to take this case to trial, we cannot prove that Deputy Dietrich's actions were not reasonable, and that is the legal analysis. What I have here is what we call the jury instructions. Whenever we go to trial, we find the appropriate law that applies to the crime, and if there's any defenses to that law, we give the law and the defenses to the jury to consider. This is what our filing, this is what my filing decision has to be based on. What will the jury receive, and what are they going to be told the law is? A peace officer is justified in homicide. This is a defense to the shooting. If the killing was committed either while the officer reasonably believed that the force was necessary to defend against the imminent threat of death or serious bodily harm, and there's another definition that doesn't apply here for involving a fleeing felon. What our officers reasonably believed was that they were in threat of serious bodily harm by Mr. Pelaez-Chavez, if not death. And just to be clear, serious bodily harm, as a jury would be instructed, can include bone fracture, concussion, loss of consciousness, impairment of any bodily member, or death. both deputies were interviewed, and they were both very clear that, that they were in fear of being killed. They were in fear of being hit by a rock, or a hammer, or a till, or a combination of all three. They were dealing with a man that was being aggressive, and we cannot overcome this legal defense. I urge everyone to read Penal Code 835, little letter A, which codifies the new law as it relates to officers' use of force based on AB 392. The legislature has declared that the decision by a peace officer to use force shall be evaluated carefully and thoroughly in a manner that reflects the gravity of that authority and the serious consequences of the use of force. I have made that evaluation in this case. Accounting for the totality of the circumstances on July 29th, the legal standards in place at the time of the shooting, the opinions of Jeffrey Noble, I find that the criminal charges are not warranted against any law enforcement personnel related to Mr. Pelaez-Chavez, and I will not be filing the criminal charges. Anyone have any questions? Andrew.
How did you determine that Pelaez-Chavez was picking up a rock in that final moment when Dietrich shoots him?
Both witnesses said they saw him picking up a rock. Dietrich thought he was picking up the same rock that he had just dropped. Powers thought he was picking up a rock that was slightly smaller and would have been easier to throw and get more velocity and speed with it. But either way, it's on the body-worn cameras.
When you watched the body-worn, or when your investigators watched the body-worn camera footage, you felt that you thought that he was picking up a rock that you'd seen.
Yeah.
You said that the deputies made a decision that one would follow a non-lethal tactic, the other would potentially use lethal force. Was there not an opportunity to deploy the taser? And was that part of what you evaluated in reaching a conclusion here?
It was. In fact, Deputy Powers did deploy his taser basically at the same moment that Mr. Pelaez-Chavez had picked up the rock and dropped it a second time, and Deputy Dietrich shot. I would say it's fair to say that all of those happened within milliseconds. Yes, Andrew.
So did Dietrich tell you why he didn't wait for the taser? Did that come out in the interview? Or?
I haven't talked to him.
Or sorry, tell your... And tell SRPD, I guess, whoever interviewed him.
The reason that his shooting is justified is because he thought at that moment that Mr. Pelaez-Chavez was going to do something that might cause him serious bodily injury or death. So at that point, it's too late to deploy a taser from someone that's not close by.
It's irrelevant to the assessment.
It is.
Okay.
It's a split-second decision made by Deputy Dietrich. And I would go so far as to say as they had been begging and pleading with him to stop, to desist, to come get some water from them, and they had to try to use other de-escalation tactics. Yes.
How is the issue of language barrier and someone's ability to understand just even by itself, let alone knowledge that drugs may be involved, how is that considered in determining someone's compliance when we say that he would not, didn't comply with commands as opposed to didn't know the language or understand the commands? How is that teased out?
It's absolutely relevant. The Santa Rosa investigators did talk to Mr. Pelaez-Chavez's employer, who said that he did understand English or broken English or speak broken English. Resident number two, I believe, communicated with him in Spanish, and then Mr. Pelaez-Chavez responded in broken English. I'm sure you'll have a chance to watch the body-worn cameras. You can hear the deputies talking to him, amigo,
I have, yes.
Agua. So there were efforts to breach that, and I believe that the efforts were sufficient in both parties' respective knowledge or ability to communicate was sufficient to demonstrate that Mr. Pelaez-Chavez was not complying. And the law, just so you know, the new law is very clear that this is not related, but kind of related, that mental illness is something that we need to consider, that 25% of officer-involved shootings involve people who are mentally ill because they don't understand what an officer is telling them. They can't comprehend what's happening. And I took that kind of mindset into consideration when I thought about what was going through Mr. Pelaez-Chavez's mind. Yes?
Your predecessor questioned the Attorney General's kind of assessment that he was armed with what could be used as a deadly weapon and not to get the case under 1506. So do you disagree with that kind of question or criticism, given that you say that it was objectively reasonable for him to consider the death?
So the AG should take the case when the officers shoot an unarmed person. So their decision to not take the case was because he was armed with a rock, the hammer, and the till. So they were correct. He was armed with three different things, and under that law, they wouldn't take the case.
And so would you consider are those considered then deadly weapons in this situation?
It just depends on how they're used. I mean, I've seen sawed-off pool sticks used. The law just says it depends on how that item is being used or brandished, so it depends on the facts and circumstances of each case.
And in this case, I guess, you determined that it was?
Yes. Yes, Jim.
Understood, you make this decision through the eyes of a reasonable law enforcement officer. Question arises in a lot of these circumstances. What would the standard be had this been maybe a private security person or if one of those property owners had on their own followed Mr. Pelaez-Chavez into the hills and he had been killed?
They don't get that instruction, 507.
You elaborate? For those of us who don't have law degrees?
So, going back, they would get a regular self-defense instruction.
Okay.
You know, they would get a regular self-defense.
Okay.
So, there's no mention of a reasonable officer, so it would be probably just a reasonable person. We would probably just ask the jury, what would you do in those circumstances? You're all reasonable jurors. Do you feel that the security officer's use of force was reasonable, et cetera, et cetera? In this case, it's the reasonable officer standard, which is why we employed Mr. Noble to assist us based on his, you'll see his resume attached to the report, his amazingly extensive background on both sides of the jury room in regards to use of force.
You'll be releasing the full report today?
Yes.
I have a quick question, maybe a two-parter too.
Today's, what your name again?
Noah. Noah. Abrams. Today's decision is done. If I can ask Ms. Lopez's conversation with the family, how did that go? And then maybe this is out of your control too, but litigation now after the fact.
It's Rocio Torres Murphy. Do you want to tell them how the conversation went today?
Sure. I feel like they took the news well, and I feel like they reacted very appropriately considering the circumstances. Of course, they are understandably upset, but overall, I believe that it went well.
It's hard. It's hard, and it's clear. You know, these legal concepts are hard for anyone to understand, and so trying to explain to David's family why we're not filing criminal charges is hurtful. But I'm confident they have an excellent civil attorney, and I told them that. And I can't, you know, this is just, are there going to be criminal charges? And that's it. So, Andrew.
You said that the officers were, I'm not sure if this is the officer's conclusion or yours, but the Pelaez-Chavez had the ability, and then you said the intent to harm the officers. How do you determine that he did? What gave you that?
I said apparent intent, because I can't
sure
read minds.
Yeah.
But we just, going through the body worns, there's photos of his face, you know, kind of looking at them, and his behavior over the past hour and 20 minutes was aggressive and fighting. He told a the officer doesn't know this, but he was telling people, you know, you're going to go down, or telling the girlfriend, I'm going to light your car on fire. He's running. He's carrying his tools. He's not relinquishing his tools. So he's looking. So that was what I based it on, was basically some of these screenshots from the body-worn camera and his movements, his holding of the weapons, his dropping and picking up the rocks.
And you just mentioned the text and the kind of the days leading up to this year. If the officers didn't know who they were chasing, right?
They did not.
So does that kind of information factor into their determination of what's objectively reasonable?
No.
Right.
No, so it's just what Deputy Dietrich and Deputy Powers knew at the time.
Did the residents communicate any of this information to them? You know,
yes, so we have dispatch logs. It's in the report, but bits and pieces were coming out from the residents to dispatch, you know, as this was all unfolding.
And it was being relayed to the deputies?
I believe so.
Okay.
They weren't asked specifically, did you hear about the rock? But we know that Deputy Dietrich showed up at the house number one, talked to the homeowners, and then showed up at house number two. So we have a sense from looking at everything about what his level of knowledge was. So everything was based on residents one, two, and three. Yes.
That particular language and moment was going to be my question too about the apparent intent. In the footage, it appeared to me that this was a pursuit catching up and a chase again. Like the way that it worked was they followed him, caught up, he ran away. They followed him, caught up, ran away, like kind of throughout. Just before this moment, Powers caught up to him in the river and Pelaez-Chavez left up the riverbank and ran into Dietrich. We don't know whether he knew he was there or not. But before that, he had been trying to run away. I was just wondering, like, that seemed clear to me in the footage. When you have a situation in which someone is trying to flee, how is that factored in terms of trying to, like, determine their level of aggressiveness and their intent to harm the deputies who he has been running away from for the last hour?
All I can say is that I don't agree that he was fleeing and didn't know that Deputy Dietrich was there. Looks to me like he was approaching Deputy Dietrich in an aggressive manner.
So that's the basis of that.
And a jury, most importantly, a jury could conclude that as well.
At any time during the pursuit, did he throw a rock, a tree limb, anything in the direction of the deputies?
No, so I think Powers caught up to him, and correct me if I'm wrong, and took, I think, the till, and kind of yelled and hit it against a tree and then pulled it back out. And then he went to throw a rock at Powers and then Powers backed off in the creek and didn't actually throw the rock.
Okay.
So he was kind of doing aggressive things, but nothing to fruition. Yes, Andrew.
I just want to ask one more about the time. You said it took a while to find the expert. It's been 15 months since the shooting. Obviously, you got the case in January. Is that the reason this took so long, was hunting that witness, or was there other?
It was a big one. Mm-hmm. It was a big one, and me wrapping my head around the fact that this is purely a legal analysis that I have to do, and fully immersing myself in the law and what a jury would be instructed if it went to trial. So.
And separating out, like, what do you mean fully wrapping? Kind of.
I'm very sympathetic to everyone in our community, and it just took me a while to reach my conclusion in this case. Yes.
So there's been, given that, and speaking about legal analysis, there's been a number of legal reforms lately to increase the ability to hold police officers accountable when there's use of force. So do you think that those have gone kind of far enough be effective, or are there still barriers?
Well, the new law is clear that police officers should use de-escalation tactics and other methods that aren't deadly when they can. So I think in any case that happens now with use of force, an officer will be forced to explain why he or she did or did not use de-escalation tactics. So I think that is a step in the right direction.
Is there particular more, like, steps any further in the right direction that you think you're going to say?
I haven't thought about improving on 8392, so no. Yes, I have another question, sorry. When there are two different officers and they have, you mentioned the affect, like how they were speaking, how much Spanish was used or not, the different interactions, and I know they're communicating with each other on radio to some degree. Looking at it from the position of what is objectively reasonable based on what they knew at the time, it always seemed to me that if there were multiple people, that their difference in reaction might demonstrate some of that, like what is objectively reasonable if one does something and the other one doesn't. Does that factor into, you know, trying to determine whether the actions of that one officer that differed from the other were
whether we should believe them?
Yeah, just that if one chooses to do this and the other one doesn't, how do you determine whether it was reasonable? Obviously, it wasn't necessary, but based on the other person's, yeah.
So the fact, are you asking me that the fact that Powers went with taser, non-lethal, and Dietrich chose pistol, firearm, lethal, does that demonstrate some kind of
difference in the, I did wonder that, but I do know you mentioned the idea of lethal cover. I was curious about the way that you mentioned the lethal cover that had been prearranged by them. So since it is in the law, you know, that as I read it, it says that deadly force cannot be used just because of for a fleeing subject from felon.
And that's not the theory we wanted.
Right. The lethal cover, in my understanding, is about having one officer, an arrangement in which one officer is going to attempt to use a less lethal means, and the other one is covering that officer that has the taser out instead of their gun. That was my understanding always, is that the lethal cover is to protect the other officer. But in this case, as we know, the taser was deployed at almost the same moment, and Dietrich was there, and Powers was much farther away. You've already said that this is based on what we think, your determination of what we see in the last moments, that Dietrich was understanding his motions. So actually, the other differences, like the language they were using or their affects, like I know Powers was a lot more like using words like friend and stop and offering water, and Dietrich was more like command-based.
Mm-hmm.
All of the above, what is reasonable. How does the difference between them factor into deciding what was reasonable?
I would say to that, that while I think Deputy Powers did an amazing job of tracking him and trying to de-escalate and spoke better Spanish, it does not detract from the objective reasonableness of Dietrich's fear of imminent harm.
Okay, thank you. And just to clarify then, essentially we're saying that Powers in his place might have done the same, like, you know, the same thing is what you would think.
Maybe.
Yeah. I think we have time for one more question. Anybody has any more?
Andrew?
Sure, yeah, I do. this is your, well, I guess you've made one more decision kind of in between, but this was the first one of these cases to come to you. And we were just talking in the newsroom, there was the Blount prosecution and the Del Valle prosecution.
Blount,
you're right.
And then the other one?
Del Valle, the officer was Scott Thorne.
Yeah.
Deputy. And in both cases, they were acquitted by juries, Sonoma County juries. Does that history of Sonoma County juries towards these cases have any impact in your decision today, or is it totally?
That's a really good question. No, but what Blount forced me to do is really dive into the law. Like, what was that? What was the Blount jury told? And if the jury is told you must acquit if this is reasonable, and we have an expert saying this is reasonable, it's something I need to consider. But I'm proud of our office. I'm proud of our attorneys. I'm proud that we have prosecuted police officers And I think we are subject matter experts in that area. I really do. I think that any DA from another county could call us and we could offer advice. But this situation truly was what the facts were, what I see on the body worns, and what my expert, who I find to be very credible, wrote in his report.
Okay, thanks everyone. We are releasing the a press release to, if you're on our list of news organizations that normally get our press releases, that will come to you along with the full report redacted. If you're not, you can call up to our front desk and ask to be placed on that list. Otherwise, you can go to our website, and the redacted report is going to be placed on our website within a half an hour. So you can get the full report one of either ways. But and also, if you're not on our normal list that get our press releases and want to be, just let us know. We can put you on it right now. But otherwise, you'll get it anyway. So does that make sense?
Who has the underlying investigative documents, like the transcript? Is that SRP?
San Jose Police Department. Yeah. Okay, thank you all.
And that's not included in what you're going to be releasing?
We're going to be releasing the autopsy report and the toxicology report and the redacted OIS report.
Okay.
And I'll put the slideshow up too.